the participants have unmuted, I will request the participants to kindly mute so that there is no voice echo and we can hear the session. Thank you so much. Let us start the forenoon 2 session in which we will be discussing about certain skills which are required while we are preparing for the Union Public Service Commission Combined Geoscientist Examination. This will be the 8th in the series of sessions which are being conducted as a part of the preparation. In this session 8, it will be divided into 2 parts. In part 1, I'm discussing about the answer writing skills for the UPSC Combined Geoscientist Examination. Part 2 will deal as to how to avoid certain common mistakes which may be done by an aspirant while preparing or appearing Combined Geoscientist Examination. Let's discuss about the first part. For this part include to provide guidance to the aspirants regarding how to improve the writing skills, how to go for a better presentation of their answers in order to score high marks, how to incorporate charts, flow diagrams and other schematic representation in their answers, and certain tips for writing impressive answers, for getting out with high scores in the mains examination. Answer writing skill is in fact something which can definitely be developed by any serious aspirant, because the answer writing skill involves the attempt to present your information in such a manner that the examiner is able to get an idea that the candidate is completely aware, he is a well-read aspirant, and he knows how to communicate his information in a precise, crisp, coherent, and proper structured manner. Let's try to understand what an examiner wants in your answer sheet so that he or she is convinced to give you the maximum marks which you deserve for knowledge. Having knowledge is not adequate enough. You must also be able to communicate and present your knowledge in a coherent manner. Well-structured and well-written answer is indicative of a sorted, organized, and well-read mind. And it is these minds that the commission seeks to select. The commission wants to select the aspirants who are well-read. So when writing the answer, let us first of all discuss certain important queries which are students for the examination. In answer to those frequently asked questions or FAQs, may I start with the fact that any aspirant must always attempt all the required number of questions. Please do not leave any question unanswered. Your best shot. Since we do not have any negative marks in the stage 2 or mains examination, it would be enough that an aspirant makes an honest attempt to answer all the questions to the best of his or her ability. For this, you try to put in your best efforts for all the required number of questions. Now, when you are asking certain queries regarding which questions to be attempted, definitely the second most important aspect is a very mindful selection of questions. Therefore, it is important that when you are selecting questions, you should always select questions in which you feel that you will be most comfortable in writing the answers. Have the requisite information. You can recall the information confidently, and you will also be able to represent it in a structured, in a schematic diagram, in a flow chart. Once you have selected the right questions to be answered, your answer must be divided into a proper introduction. This few lines of introduction will help to create an atmosphere that the aspirant is well aware of the right answer and the information which is sought for in the question. It also sets the tone for the rest part of your answer. The next is going to be the main body of your answer, where you will be putting the required diagrams, the required equations, formulae, solving the answers, or discussing and enumerating the points which are required as per the question. Lastly, you must have a logical conclusion to your answer. Therefore, when your answer has a proper introduction, body, and conclusion, it gives also an insight into your mind frame. It suggests that even under the pressure of writing the examination, even under the constraint of time, a particular aspirant is sorted out in his mind and is also confident of structuring the answer. He or she is not only telling the right answer, but also providing it in a proper coherent format. When you are answering any particular query or any question in the examination, try to deconstruct your answer into different distinct points. Once you have sorted out the main 5 to 6 points or 7-8 points, that depends on the question, once these points have been delineated, you can build upon each point individually so that 2-3 sentences on that particular point are mentioned. Once you deconstruct your answer into distinct points and build upon those points individually, it enables an aspirant to include all the required information. It also ensures that no aspect is left out of the answer. And it also ensures that there is a proper flow of information from the basic points building up to the advanced stage and proper conclusion to the answer. Let us see how this can be achieved. Whenever you are writing an answer, you should try to have an order in that particular answer. It should be a gradation of information, one point leading to another, and then to the next, and then to a proper conclusion. So, your answer must be very orderly. The expression must be effective to cast an impression on what you want to express And it should also be very exact. Please do not beat about the bush. As far as the Union Public Service Commission is concerned, it is the most unbiased and very active institution which gives due consideration to the exact expression of the candidate. If you do not know the answer, they are very experts and they will definitely find out that the aspirant is trying to beat about the bush and not coming to the exact answer. This is not casting a good impression for the aspirant. Therefore, students must ensure effective as well as exact expression. And this is required with due economy of words. You must try and make a practice to express your answer in the space limit which is provided in the UPSC answer sheet. So you must try to express yourself with minimum words. You must also try to keep in mind that the UPSC always tries to select the best. And one of the characteristics of an evolved, mature, educated mind, which is filled with requisite knowledge and also has the skills to put this knowledge into practice, is defined by a person who can express the entire idea in minimum words. You do not need to write pages and pages to express simple ideas. Therefore, whenever you have a coherent, structured, and concise answer, this is what fetches the maximum marks in the commission examinations. Thus, you must make a note that your expression must be exact, effective. The answer must be structured and coherent and to the point. It must adhere to the exact query which is put forth in the question. The second aspect which an aspirant must take care of while answering is the one in which you must use a correct language, nevertheless, a simple one. You are not required to have, you know, a very flowery language. Must practice due economy of words, and for that to take place, it is important that you are using the correct sentence framing. The correct sentence framing is required in order to be able to show that your language skills are also at par with your information. So your technical understanding and your knowledge about your subject is extremely important, and equal importance is given to a simple, effective and correct grammar. The spellings should be correct and your sentence framing should be accurate as per the grammar rules. That ensures that it is a perfect combination of knowledge, language, skills, and orderly and effective expression, and an educated, well-balanced mind. This is what they want to seek in a particular candidate while they are selecting the candidate. You are answering. Let us now see another important aspect which you must take into consideration. You must correlate your answer with related applications. So if any particular aspect, for example, the satellites, or if you are going for radioactive dating method, or you are making a study of the mineral deposits of India, whatever are the related applications, they can be mentioned with suitable examples. Examples may be in the Indian context or even in the world context. Sometimes the question itself mentions that the answers may be illustrated or supplemented with the help of diagrams and some suitable Indian examples. In such a case, you are supposed to give an Indian example and the related applications. However, if only suitable examples is mentioned, you can nevertheless go ahead with any standard example which may relate to India or in any other part of the world. Let us come to the next aspect. You must support your answer with well depicted diagrams, which may be drawn with the help of a pencil. All the diagrams, it is important that you have a suitable caption. A suitable caption is definitely required while you are answering, so that your diagram denotes a specified idea, an objective, a reason as to why it has been included as a part of your answer. The diagram definitely needs to be well labeled, so that all parts of the diagram along with the caption which you have mentioned are in complete coherence to the query which has been put forward in the particular question which is being answered. Next, let us come to another aspect. Sometimes the question mentions to illustrate your answer with help of diagrams or sketches. Many a times they may not specifically mention that you need to give a diagram. Nevertheless, it is always suggested to incorporate some flowchart, a block diagram, or a schematic representation of the steps, if it is a stepwise derivation of formula, or it is a stepwise method for some synthesis in organic chemistry, or stepwise mechanism of different chemical reactions. So such sorts of flowcharts, block diagrams, and schematic representation must be incorporated in your answer in addition to the text part which you are writing. So whatever you are writing, in addition to that, any answer which has diagrams and schematic representations always scores better marks. So it is requested that you go ahead with such representative and illustrative answers which tend to fetch better marks in the examination as compared to other categories. Then you may go ahead with further skills which are required for answering. These answer writing skills include what is mentioned as keeping track of the time which is available, the space which is required, and the word limit which is there for answering. Therefore, an aspirant must suitably divide the time such that there is enough time being dedicated to each of the questions. You must try to finish off the answer to a particular question in the provided space and word limit. Another aspect which you must take care of is the aspect where a candidate's personality is also reflected in a neat, clean, and legible handwriting. Here, the examiner is not looking for calligraphy. So it's not a question whether how beautiful your handwriting is. It is definitely soothing to the eyes if you write in a clean and legible handwriting. So please do not make any illegible handwritings in your answer sheet due to haste or paucity of time. And that is why you need to be mindful of the amount of time you can devote to a particular question. To finish off the question within the allocated space and the time which you feel is suitable such that you are able to answer all the questions. You have enough time to write in a proper handwriting in all the questions. Whenever you are choosing the questions, it is always better to attempt the questions which have less number of marks. For example, if you have 215 marks questions, or in that place, if you try to attempt 3 questions of 10 marks each, in both the cases, you are attempting 30 marks questions. But if you attempt 15 marks questions and 2 questions are there, your combined score may be less in comparison to the condition where you have chosen to answer 3 questions of 10 marks each. Such a condition, because there are 3 questions to which you have given the answers, and there are 3 places where you can get marks, a combined total of all the marks tends to be generally in most of the cases higher than a candidate who has attempted only 2 questions of 15 marks each. So if you are comfortable and you know the answers, you try to attempt the questions with less number of marks so that your score is high and you are there in the final merit list. Another aspect is numericals and questions which involve diagrammatic representation. Questions involving numericals and diagrammatic representations are always more scoring. In fact, in numericals, if you give all the steps to the answer and your answer is correct, reported in the proper unit, you tend to get full marks for that answer. This may not be the case in an answer where you just have to discuss or elaborate or enumerate in text manner. Therefore, it is important, if you know the numericals, if you know the formulae, and you are sure you'll be able to do the calculation, it is always better to go for numericals or the questions which themselves ask you to illustrate diagrammatically. Getting full marks in numericals diagram representation is much easier. It is much more common rather than getting full marks in a question which involves text information. Now, whenever you are writing any formula or any equation, or you are, you know, putting forth the organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, or physics and geophysics, it is important that you denote every term while you are writing an equation or a formula. So that should be specifically mentioned if you are using any symbols. So each symbol in the formula may be denoted properly. Now, when you are writing an answer, there may be certain keywords or key sentences which form the cornerstone of your answer. And the gist and the most important part which need to be answered. So when that is the case, what you can do is that you can simply use the pencil to underline those keywords and sentences, so that you score much better. Whenever you are writing answers, try to write them in bullet form. Now, when you are writing answers in bullet form means different points. You just try to have different points. Rather than having a paragraph, you can just write the main salient points. Especially for questions which involve 5 marks, you can go ahead with writing your answer in point form. Now, what it does, it does 3 important aspects. See, in the first aspect, the examiner will immediately know that you know all the salient points of this particular question. The second is that it will save a lot of time in writing and, you know, creating complex sentences and using conjunctions, using the right grammar, preparing a proper syntax in the paragraph. So it saves a lot of time. You just write the salient points. And third is that if you write in point form, it is generally observed that the marks you score are much higher. So on all the 3 counts, in saving your time, expressing to the examiner that you know the answer, scoring high marks, in all the 3 counts, it is very, very effective to represent your answer in the form of points. So it will help you in that manner. I have probably, am I audible? Can some of the aspirants respond, please? Because somebody is mentioned. Okay, then Neelu ji, you may try to check the connection at your end, please. Thank you so much. So I will now be moving ahead. Thank you, Saloni ji and Ritapalli and all those who have responded to the question. That also gives an idea that the audience is alert and listening to every sentence, which gives an immense satisfaction when you are trying to communicate. The others are attentive, they are listening to you patiently. So definitely thank you a lot. Let us move ahead. Try to illustrate your answers and your concepts with certain examples, as I said earlier, and certain applications. Now, why have I written this point over here? There is a specific reason. Earlier, I was discussing the structure of the answer. Here, when I'm talking about giving your answer in bullet form, I have noted down this point so that once you are writing the points of an answer, the last point may be example, as such and such a place in India or abroad, so that you give a proper explanation. So if you remember, we had over here, we had an point over here. So we had a point over here when we were talking about the grammar and effective screening, right? So once we have decided that, okay, we will have a particular exact expression and we will be having it in a specified structured manner, then even after that, what we can do is the next step, we said, okay, when you are having a particular legible handwriting, you are trying to go in for the numericals, then you want to denote every term. So you are here to denote every term to the answer. You want to have a better representation of your formulae and equations. So once you want to do that, then illustrating a bullet answer with proper examples ensures your additional marks, or you can say additional means full marks. Additional means, supposing the examiner is trying to give you 3 marks, so he tends to give you 4 or 5 because you have given very suitable examples, right? So this is what I meant. Now, if you analyze the previous year question papers, you can make a note of the topics on which the questions are being asked frequently. This is what the, our newly joined officers in the geology, chemistry, and geophysics stream have done at their end and shared with you. So the aspirants would have noticed that when the geology, geophysics, and chemistry stream people are talking, they have provided a particular, list of topics, like these are the most important topics from each segment of the paper. So each segment of the paper have delineated topics. They have done it at their end and they have shared it with you. Definitely you can use that information. But may I suggest to the participants, kindly do that at your end also. Try to analyze the previous year question papers. Note down the topics and the questions which are being asked frequently. Sometimes the same questions are also repeated after a gap of say 2-3 years. Nevertheless, even if the questions are not repeated, you can definitely note down the topics from which mostly the questions are asked. Once you have a list of those topics, once you have a list of those questions which are repeatedly asked, you can start practicing how to write answer to those questions. So this is, I suppose, a very important exercise which must be done at the end of the aspirants. Must do it. They can also make use of the suggestions which have been provided by the our newly joined officers, but they must do this exercise at their own end also. Now, the participants are also requested to keep on practicing the derivations, the formula, and the diagrams. Why? Because as already mentioned, these are very, very scoring. So the more conversant you are, the more adept you are, the writing of answers needs to be impeccable. It needs to be flawless. It needs to be filled with the requisite information reflecting the knowledge level. It needs to be represented in the form of schematic diagrams with proper captions and labeling reflecting the ingeniousness of the aspirant. It must be having properly termed denoted formulas to show how thorough you are with the subject. Okay. In numerical questions, you must write down all the steps. There is no scope of leaving out the steps. Please do not think that you can just write the final answer. Please pen down all the steps and give the correct unit. And you must have some time sorted out at the end of the paper so that you can have some time for revising your answer sheet. Once you revise, if you find any issues or if you find something you have missed out or something probably strikes your mind, you have not added, you want to add another point. All these aspects can be taken care of when you revise your answer sheet. So revising the answer sheet is definitely one of the best method to ensure that you have given the best answer and there is nothing which has been left out from your end. So now let's see some of the sample questions which are asked in different streams of the examination. I mean, whether it is the geology or hydrogeology or it is chemistry or geophysics, this is just to help the aspirants get a glimpse of the nature of questions which are asked by the UPSC. This is point one. And point two of this exercise, why I have put it here is, see, the sample question papers are available on the commission website. You can go to the website and you can search for the previous question papers of the combined geoscientist examination. You can definitely have that. And you can try to make an analysis as to what is the nature of questions. So I'll see some of the questions like describe the landforms produced by fluvial actions with Indian examples. So here you must note that it is being asked of you that all the landforms which are produced by fluvial action, they need to be described by you. So describe is the keyword. You are supposed to give the proper description and they have said with Indian examples. So here, if you are giving any examples of Oxbow Lake, then supposing it should be an Indian example. You should not try to give any examples from the world over. You're talking about natural levees. So all the examples which you quote, they should be of Indian nature. And for every landform, you can provide a diagram with a caption. So this is what is required. This is how you are supposed to answer this particular question. Now, supposing you have another question, discuss the geochemical characteristics of rare earth elements. So here, the keyword is, what are you supposed to do about the characteristics of rare earth elements? You have to discuss. When you are discussing, simply describing, you will just describe it in detail. But when you are discussing, then you should have all the possible, components. You should have all the possible points and you should not leave out any characteristic, because when you are discussing, a discussion means a threadbare analysis. So you should focus on such words. See another example of a question, enumerate the salient features of satellite imagery and aerial photographs. Enumerate means list down. Tell all of them. So you have to pen down all the features which are important for satellite imagery and those which are important for aerial photographs. In another question, it is asked, in X-ray fluorescence technique, matrix affects interference in analysis. So just comment and justify your answer. So what you are supposed to do in this question, first of all, you have to comment on this particular sentence. Do you agree with this particular sentence? Are you aware that matrix affects interference in analysis? So what is your observation? What is your knowledge? What is your view? So you have to give a comment. And this comment has to be a critical comment. And then you have to justify your answer. If you agree with the statement, then you have to justify, you have to give the example to justify your answer. This is how I agree. If you have any critical observation, that particular observation also needs to be justified. Describe the basic principles of radiometric dating of rocks is another question. So here you have to describe the principle of radiometric dating, right? When it is specifically asking you to describe the basic principle, then please do not ponder off or start with other aspects as to why it is required and all that. First, the most important aspect that the examiner wants to see whether the principle of radiometric dating has been properly answered. Okay. So define the, another thing is define magnitude of an earthquake. Straight away they are asking simply define. So you are just supposed to write the magnitude of an earthquake and how you measure it. So you tell the different scales of measurements and you say how it can be measured. So the words like describe, discuss, enumerate, comment, justify. So all this is what needs to be taken into consideration. As you can say, from the selection of questions, it is visible to you, the participants, that they are not defined, they are not restricted to any one particular stream. The questions have been selected from the geology paper, from the chemistry paper, from the geophysics paper. So they are representative of all the three streams. Let us make a note of another set of questions. I hope the participants have noted down questions which have been discussed here. So let us have an observation of a few more questions which can be seen. This another question to write a note on gravity anomaly at the mid oceanic ridges. Now, if somebody asks to write a note, so that means you have to pen down the salient aspects of the gravity anomaly. And when you are writing a note, it is important to have a proper introduction, body and conclusion, because your note on gravity anomaly must encompass not only all the points, but also be presented in a very structured manner. Another very technical question from the chemistry stream is Fe2O3 adopts inverse spinel structure while CO3O4 adopts normal spinel structure. So how you can explain it? So here the emphasis will be how well you are able to explain the difference. Okay. Now what is Walther's law? So we know the Walther's law of facies. So first, you are supposed, what is Walther's law means you are supposed to give the law and then you substantiate your answer by discussing the fluvial facies model. So Walther's law of facies, first you have to describe it and then you have to discuss in relation to the fluvial facies model. So the fluvial facies model should be able to substantiate your answer. The way you describe and discuss about the fluvial facies, it should substantiate the Walther's law. That is, it is in accordance with the Walther's law. Another question from the geophysics stream. So we are having questions from geology, geophysics, chemistry, all streams. Principle of gravity method and seismic method of exploration and application. So here you must discuss the gravity method principle and give its application. You must discuss the seismic method exploration principles and give the application. See, another question from the geology stream, which refers to paleontology part, is to describe the internal structure of a brachiopod cell with suitable diagrams. So here you not only have to describe the structure, you also have to show the diagram they have specifically mentioned. When they mention specifically, there are different marks allocated for the description in the text part and for a well-labeled diagram. So here it is in fact compulsory. You have to give a diagram of the internal structure of a brachiopod cell, and you must also describe it in addition. Another question from the geophysics stream is to draw the P wave velocity and S wave velocity and density variation with depth from the surface of the earth. So here you have to show how the P wave velocity, S wave velocity and density varies with depth from the surface of the earth. It specifically mentions they want to have a neat sketch diagram. So once they tell you to draw with the help of a sketch diagram, a diagram with the proper caption and the proper labeling is extremely important. And such kind of questions, if you draw the correct fully labeled diagram, you are supposed to fetch complete full marks for such questions. So it is important that you are able to understand the key words. हर क्वेश्चन में एक कीवर्ड होता है कि व्हाट द एग्जामिनर वांट्स. सो यू मस्ट हैव सच कीवर्ड्स, यू मस्ट हैव आई टू सी सच कीवर्ड्स, सो दैट यू आर एबल टू गिव द एक्यूरेट आंसर. सो हियर राइटिंग अ नोट एक्सप्लेन what it is or substantiate your answer means it should be in consonance, it should confirm, it should be in relation to that. Then describe the structure or draw a sketch. So these are the keywords: draw, describe, enumerate, substantiate, write a note, discuss, describe. So all this is required to be answered correctly. Let us have a look at some of the sample answers. The sample answer, for example, if you have a question like explain the geostationary satellite orbits and the sun synchronous satellite orbits and their applications in remote sensing, so you can just start with telling about the geostationary satellite orbits and application in remote sensing. Then you can tell about the sun synchronous satellite orbit, the application in remote sensing. And you can also illustrate your answer where you can use a pencil to draw a diagram, and you can represent how a sun synchronous orbit is there and how a geostationary satellite is orbiting. So the geostationary satellite orbit and the sun synchronous satellite orbit can be represented in the form of a labeled diagram. So the diagram must definitely, the diagrammatic sketch which you are making, it must have a proper labeling. It must have a proper labeling, and your answer can be differentiated in point forms. If you have it in point forms, what will happen is that the examiner is very clear as to how the answer is supposed to be written, and you are also required to give an example. If you give an example here, you give an example of inset satellite over here. So giving example also means that the aspirant is very, very clear as to what he or she is writing about or what he or she is talking about. So giving the definitions, giving it in point or bullet forms, underlining certain keywords, underlining keywords, giving your answer in precise, concise, limited words, exact structure, giving it in bullet forms, underlining the keywords or sentences, giving the required examples, putting the examples wherever applicable, having a neat diagram which is labeled, a diagram with a pencil and labeling it. So all these factors will help to get you a maximum mark. So if this is the manner how you will answer all the questions in due economy of space, due respect to the number of words, correct grammar, correct spelling, concise, coherent, crisp, exact expression, correct sentence framing, underlining the keywords, giving the required examples, providing schematic, well-labeled diagrams with captions, all this will help to get you maximum marks. Okay, so this is extremely important that you keep these in point. Somebody is asking whether we are provided plain sheet or what. I don't know if you have been in the session in since the starting, but at the start of the session itself, I have shown you a sample UPSC answer sheet. You can have a look at it. This is a sample UPSC answer sheet. I hope it is clearly understood now by the participant. Thank you for responding. Definitely, it is my duty to answer all the queries and any queries which the participants either ask me or they put in the chat. So immediately I will be responding. Thank you all. So now let us go to the next aspect. Also, if you have to answer, for example, you have certain derivations to be done and you have to work out a particular series of steps, then whatever is the problem which has been stated, you kindly give, introduce the problem. And then when you are giving the equations as to step wise, it is important that you give them a proper number so that there will be a sequence of steps and the examiner is very clear, okay, this is the first one and then you come to the second and then the third, and then the fourth, the fifth, and finally the sixth conclusion. Okay, so here you are supposed to, you know, give it in a sequential manner. And if you give a number, it becomes very clear. As I say, the more systematic you are, the more organized you are, the more structured your answer is, it gives an insight into your thought process. It gives an insight into the personality of the aspirant. And it shows that the aspirant is not only knowledgeable, but a very organized individual. The individual is very confident and structured and orderly in approach. An orderly approach, a well-structured approach is required. And all the steps you should mention so that you get full marks for this question. So please do not leave out any step. You should enumerate all the steps in detail. Okay. After that, say for example, in addition to giving the steps, if you are required to give the explanation, so after the sixth, you have the seventh equation, the eighth, the ninth, tenth, and finally to derive your final formula. Now, once you are deriving your final formula, it is a good idea that you have given your steps numbers like In this slide, it was like first, second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth steps. After this, the answer is continued. You have seventh, eighth, ninth, tenth step. And in the 11th step, you have your final derivation. So what you do is you just try to box it. You just try to box it, because here underlining will not do because it's not a text. So this is a formula. So you try to put a box around it, that this is the final derivation which you have got, and how you have done and why you explain it. So you can give the answer, give a proper explanation as to why it is so. So you must try to restrict your answers to the provided page limit. So if it's a 15 marks question, then they will give you a certain space. And then again, the next question will be written. So whatever space they have provided for 10 marks question, whatever space they have provided for the 5 marks question, whatever space they have provided for 15 marks question, uske baad you'll have the next question. So what you do is that you restrict your answer within the provided space. You must make a note to remember this. So just in addition to providing an elaborate discussion on how to develop proper answer writing skills, suggesting how to write a good answer to fetch maximum marks, giving a glimpse of sample questions from geology, geophysics, and chemistry stream, giving a glimpse of sample answers, giving a glimpse of the UPSC answer sheet. We will now move ahead for certain tips as to how the most important parts which we have discussed in this session regarding answering skills. I will just sum them up for important tips as to how you will go ahead for answering in the mains examination. The first and most important, practice answer writing from previous year question papers. So go to the commission website, download the previous year question papers, and start practicing answers to them. You must work on your speed as well as accuracy. You have to answer within the specified space, word, and time limit, but you also need to take care that the answer needs to be accurate. For this, the best idea is just go through the entire question paper in the first 5 minutes. See all the questions, try to make a mental note as to how much time is required to be distributed for answering the 5 marks, 10 marks, and 15 marks questions which you are attempting, and leave out some time for revising your answer sheet. You must carefully read and understand every question before you start answering. So read the entire question, what it is asking. Just don't see, okay, this is the satellite topic. Fine, it's a satellite topic. Let me start writing about the satellite. So it should not be, you should not be in such a hurry. There is constraint of time, but there is not so much constraint that you cannot even carefully read the question. Kindly read the question. It is asking for your comment, or it is asking for a diagram, or it is asking for Indian examples, or it is asking for the world's best example of this resource. So accordingly, you should answer. Then you must give special attention to words like write a note, describe, elaborate. Already some sentences given, now you have to expand on it. You have to elaborate on it. Discuss. So you have to discuss both the pros as well as the cons. So the either of the two has to be there. write an essay on, so then it has to be a proper essay kind of a format. Paragraph format is required, and you must have an introduction and topic wise paragraphs, and then a final conclusion. Analyze. So whenever you are carrying out an analysis, again you have to be very critical. Analysis has to be done. So you have to be analyzing that particular statement in a critical manner. So give special attention to these words. What is the question asking? Is it asking you to describe, or it is asking you to analyze? Is it asking you to elaborate, or it is asking you to write an essay or a note? And accordingly, you should answer. So as I said, you have to give due consideration to space and word. Try to illustrate your answer with suitable examples. If they ask, you have to give, because there are separate marks for examples. If examples are not mentioned in the question, nevertheless, you give the example, you score much higher than others. Your writing needs to be legible. Because a person cannot give you marks if they are not even able to read what you have written. And as I said, a clear, legible handwriting also gives an insight to the personality of the aspirant, that the aspirant himself is a very sorted out, organized person. Give graphical representations to your answer wherever it is possible. If it is asked, you have to mention. If it is not asked, then also, if you write a schematic representation, if you draw a sketch, if you give a graphical representation, you will definitely have a much better answer and much better marks you will be scoring. Answer the required number of questions. Again, I'm saying, please do not leave any question. Try to give your best shot at it, and some marks you will be able to get, because it's a written examination. There are no negative marks. There is no penalty for not giving the exact right answer. So you can try to attempt all the questions. Whenever a question asks you to explain, then your explanation has to be logical and sequential. One step leads to the other, to the next, finally to the conclusion. So your explanations must be very logical and sequential. And before you submit the answer sheet, kindly revise whatever you have written. If there is any scope for improvement, improve your answer. If you have not had time earlier, you have not drawn a sketch or diagram, draw it now. If you have left out a caption from a diagram, put it in place. If some labeling is missing, ensure that the diagram is properly labeled. If some point you left out, try to incorporate it. If you have not been able to underline some keywords or important sentences in your answer, try to do it. If you have not provided a captioned box to your final derivation or formula, and enclose it in a proper captioned box. If you have not given the meaning of certain terms, certain symbols which you have used in your formula, give it. If you do this before submitting your answer sheet, definitely you will be earning some 15-20 points extra. Otherwise, if you would have submitted your answer sheet without revision, then what would have happened? You would have lost these marks. So kindly revise your answer sheet before you submit them. This is what I wanted to discuss with the participants regarding the answer writing skills. So whenever you have the notification for the examination, whenever you have the notification for the examination, kindly go through the notification and kindly see that whatever specifications have been provided in the notification, accordingly you make you know, you try to follow those particular instructions for that particular year of examination, right? So somebody is asking, why is it important to underline the keywords while answering, what impression it makes on the examiner? Okay, sir, what we are trying to do here is that we are simply trying to, you know, there is a query. For example, I have to describe a certain aspect. So I just want to catch the attention of the examiner that a particular aspect has been answered correctly. If there is some keyword or some very important sentence, I underline it with the help of a pencil so that it comes to the notice of the examiner that yes, that particular aspect has been answered. It is just a small highlighting skill. I'm not saying it is compulsory. It is simply suggested because it immediately catches the attention of the examiner that the requisite information has been provided. Right? So that is the idea. Okay. So now once we have discussed about the answer writing skills, I will just take the remaining time which we have in the forenoon session to discuss about certain common mistakes which can be avoided when you are appearing for the mains examination. So in this session, we will just be discussing about some of the mistakes which sometimes inadvertently are made by the aspirants, how we can avoid them, and what are the important aspects which we need to make note when we are preparing for the exam and also when we are appearing for the examination. So these we will be discussing in this part two of the session. So let us have a look at some of the mistakes which are admitted by previous aspirants. They have discussed and they have mentioned that these were some of the inadvertent mistakes which were done from our end, due to which probably I was not able to score that much high. Because, you know, every mark in the examination counts. As you know, it's a competitive examination. So every mark you secure in the exam is important, and every mark which you lose is also a great loss. So in order to avoid losing marks and in order to ensure that you get the maximum possible marks for the efforts which you have put in for the preparation, let us see some of the things which you should avoid so that you do not lose. Okay. So the first thing is, sometimes people try to be very, very selective. There is absolutely no issue in focusing on certain areas. You can definitely give in your best efforts to prepare certain segments from which the questions are asked frequently. Nevertheless, in the first round of your preparation, which you should start minimum 6 months before, so in the first round of your preparations, you must prepare your entire syllabus. You should not have any topic which has not been prepared properly by you. So the first round of preparation should be such that you prepare the entire syllabus and do not leave any topic unprepared. Only in the second stage of your revision, you may start more focus and you know, you should have more focused approach to the topics which you feel are likely to be having questions in the coming examination. So you can have more attention and more practice for those selected topics. Nevertheless, you must try to prepare the entire syllabus. That is point one. And definitely, as I have said, it is really important that you attempt all the questions. Because it's a written examination, you must try to attempt all the questions. The selection of question is also important. There are many times the aspirants say that I felt I will be able to answer the question, but when I started writing the answer, then I felt that probably another question would have been better answered by me. Nevertheless, since I had lost time in answering the question, I could not go back and answer another question, but later on I realized that it was a better choice. So when you are choosing, when you are selecting the questions to be answered, you must have a wise selection and make a thorough understanding which is the question which can be answered best by me. You should always attempt those questions. Then time management. Many times people come out and they will start saying, I did not have enough time to answer, so I could not revise, or I did not have enough time to answer, so I left one question unanswered, I left two questions unanswered. So this is because you have not divided your time equally in all the number of questions which you have to do. So you must have effective time management. Okay. And give your answer in the provided space. Do not try to write outside space. Do not try to have some sentences which are having any problems. Do not try to put your PPM values or some other values in percentage. Be very careful about the unit which you are using for any particular thing, and then try to give certain source of your data also. If the data is random, it is not accepted. Try to write only within the boundaries of the answer sheets. Otherwise, the people may feel that you are going beyond the boundaries. Then if you are giving any explanation to anything, it should be a proper explanation. It should not leave certain things unanswered by the aspirant. So you should not leave certain things unanswered. It should be within the boundaries. Your sentences, your spellings, your expressions, your syntax should always be proper. Then whenever you are trying to have all the points, supposing all of them are actually having merged, in fact they are connoting a single aspect, do not try to simply elaborate it just to show that you are writing so many points, right? So do not try to do like this. Try to have a separate point only if it is a separate heading, or it is a different idea, it's a different topic. Do not try to simply elaborate in a single component into multiple components, because these things, they feel that you should not have done it like that. A single point cannot be just simply repeatedly stated for different points. So sometimes they feel that you are trying to extend the answer in this manner. So just stick to what is the accurate information being asked. You need not, as I said, beat about the bush. You need not answer collateral things. You need to be very specific and precise. And whenever you are having, as I said, sometimes in the formula you use expressions, but what is that particular, what expression that particular thing is denoting? So people tell me, I've written the formula, I've written the exact final derivation, but I have not mentioned the terminology which has been used. So that is extremely important, because unless and until you mention the terminology which is being used, that does not denote a specific meaning to the examiner. Mostly when you are answering numericals, there are unit conversion involved. May I request the participants to kindly be on mute, please? There is some sound coming from the background. So when you are answering the numericals, many a times they will ask you in a particular unit, but the values which are provided are not in that unit. So you need to convert the unit and then give your answer. So unless and until sometimes they felt, oh, I have done the correct calculation. Calculation is correct, but I did not convert it in the required unit. So if the unit is not correct, then what happens is that your answer becomes erroneous. So it is important that whenever you are answering, it has to be converted into the proper unit. Many times, so many aspirants are telling, I forgot to convert the unit. I did the calculation correctly. So calculation is important, but the correct statement and the correct unit of measurement is equally important. So you must answer the numericals in the correct unit of measurement. This is important because many of my friends, colleagues, and certain aspirants said regarding the same thing. Whenever you are writing the derivations, whenever you are having a flow chart expressions, whenever you have the formula derivation or the organic chemistry, the synthesis steps, in fact. So all these steps, you should not jump steps. Okay, fine. Directly from, acetone, you are just jumping to the alcohol synthesis step. You should write the intermediary steps. So you should not leave out any step, and you must revise your answer before submitting, because the people who revised were able to gain, marks by correcting certain aspects themselves rather than the examiner correcting them. But those who did not have the time, who did not manage the time effectively, they had to submit the answer sheet without revision, and they were themselves not sure if something was missing in their answer sheets before submitting it. So these are the some of the things which you should try to keep a track of to avoid any such mistakes which were done by previous aspirants, and try to make the maximum of the chance provided to you so that there is not any iota of space that you will lose out on certain marks. There is no iota of problem that you will feel that I lost marks because of certain issues. So that's why it is better that you take care of such aspects from the beginning itself. If you ensure it during your preparation, I'm absolutely sure that you will come out with flying colors in the final examination and make a very high position in the final merit list, where your selection will be ensured. Keeping in mind, you start your preparation minimum 6 months before. In the first stage, you try to cover the entire syllabus so that you don't have to leave out any questions. In the second stage, you focus out on the frequently asked questions and the topics and try to have a more focused approach, a more insightful approach, a more in-depth, detailed study for this particular topics, so that in case they are asked, you are much better prepared to answer them. Try to answer in a good handwriting, legible handwriting, in the correct grammar, correct sentence framing. Try to have labeled diagrams and captioned ones. Try to have good sketches. Try to give examples and try to have the terms denoted of the formula. To ensure all these things, I am definitely sure that you answer like this, and you then revise your answer sheet, correct any information, and then submit it. You will definitely score very high marks. There are certain queries which I can read in the chat box. See, advertisement against a particular post, I think it has been answered. And that depends upon the vacancy year. So I think that has been taken care of. And they will be providing space in the answer sheet. The answer sheets are also available online. So they provide certain space in the answer sheet. Within that space, you are supposed to write. If they provide the word limit for that you have to see the question paper for every different question. You have to see what is the marks. You have to see what is the space they have provided in the answer sheet. And accordingly, you have to answer it. Generally, for 10 marks, you will have two pages, two sites to answer. For 15, you will have three sites to answer. For 5 marks, you will have some space and then another question. So you are supposed to limit your answer in that space. And geology and hydrogeology session has already been covered. Definitely. So I think many of the queries are being answered. This is what we felt we should discuss with the aspirants regarding how to give a proper improved answer, how to give a more illustrative answer so that you score better marks than others, and how to avoid certain common mistakes while preparing for the examination and appearing for the combined geoscientist examination conducted by the Union Public Service Commission. So I hope it has been useful to the aspirants. It will prove useful when they appear for the examination. One question is there. Do we need to explain the terms which we have used in labeling? See, if you are discussing the answer, then you can have those explanations. But if you are just writing, because there are specific, it depends on the kind of question. There are questions which tell you to simply draw a sketch, neat labeled sketch for a particular thing. So you are supposed to give a neat and labeled diagram. So you cannot start describing the terms in the labeling over there. But nevertheless, if it is a combination of text, answer, as well as a labeled diagram, you can definitely have those terms explained in the text part. Okay. So these are some of the questions I could see.
Nidhi, thank you for a wonderful session.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
I think there is one question that is popping up, is writing a note and writing an essay.
Okay.
If you can tackle that one. And there is whether we can use a sketch pen.
Regarding sketch pen or regarding any other colored pens and all, kindly make a note that the Union Public Service Commission in the announcement itself mentions that you can use a blue or black ballpoint pen, and that's also, I think, on the safe side. You should go with a single colored pen, use a blue colored pen, and if you are drawing diagrams, use a pencil to draw the sketches or diagrams. Okay. And even if you are underlining some word, use a pencil. That is good enough. Kindly do not use different colors for coloring the diagram. Do not use different color pens for writing. It's not allowed. It should not be done. And the best guide to appearing for the UPSC examination is the UPSC announcement. Every year you have to fill the form. The announcement gives a clear guideline as to how you are supposed to answer. Follow the guidelines which are provided, and we do not use colored pens and colors and sketch pens. Please don't do that. That is one question. The other question is, right, see, if you are writing an essay type answer, if you are asked to write an essay, so what is required is that in an essay type answer, you'll have paragraph wise answering, you'll have a proper introduction, a framework of the question as per the question which has been asked, and then you will have in the body, you will have it differentiated into 2-3 paragraphs depending upon the different points which you are covering, and then you'll have a proper conclusion. So that is answering in the kind of an essay type format. So you're writing an essay on a particular statement which has been provided in the question. So this is how you write an essay. So when you're providing a note on something, so in that case, you need not write very elaborately as you write in an essay. Nevertheless, try to have an introductory statement, try to have a concluding statement, and all the salient points. Here you have the liberty that you can put it in point form, so that you have all the important points noted down. So you have that. But when you are asked specifically to write an essay on this, then it should be structured in the form of an essay format. Okay. So that is the way you can answer a note and an essay. I hope it is answered, sir. Any other query? Can we draw diagrams with? See, sir, again and again, what I want to express is that be rest assured that UPSC is the best institution to conduct exams and get them evaluated in the best possible manner with experts of all streams. So you draw it with a pen and pencil, it's not going to make much of an issue of that. The best method is to draw a diagram with a pencil. This is what we all of us are taught since the school days. I don't think so any of us were taught to draw diagrams with pen and all. So the best thing is you draw a diagram with a pencil and you simply label it. That's how diagrams are always drawn, right? So that is the best way to do it. And use a single colored pen. Again, it is mentioned in the notification. Please go through it and follow that. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Nidhi, for a wonderful session. I hope participants have gathered much information through your this lively presentation, and you have shared your experience very nicely. Yes, what you have thought, what you have shared is definitely going to help each and everyone. There has been some queries regarding the vacancies. Let me clear that. We do not have any information regarding the vacancies. Vacancies are taken care of by the central headquarters of GSI and the UPSC. So please do not ask whether there will be vacancy or not, whether, in coming 5 years, what will be the vacancy type or what will be the post. We are here to help our, share our expertise, share our experience. And as you have seen, Nidhi ma'am has been taking wonderful sessions since yesterday, and let me tell you, whatever we are sharing, you can use in any of the examinations, whether it is for GSI, whether it is for CGWB, or whether it is for any, or whether it is for civil services of conducted by UPSC or state PSC. You can use this knowledge in anywhere, even in your MSc classes. Whatever we are saying is nothing from out of the sky. We are saying what is available, what we have felt, and bringing all the thoughts, all the experience together in this platform. And you are most welcome to, again, I'm getting whether there is a session for hydrogeology. No, there is no separate session of hydrogeology, but the geology papers has been already taken care of in yesterday's session from I think 4 p.m. onward. These are available in our Facebook accounts, which I have shared the link. They will be in our timeline for next 7 days. Please go through them, take preparing your own notes. We are not going to give any notes to you. No PPT will be shared. Those you have to take your own notes, as we have been saying. Nidhi Max has been saying you have to make your own notes. Each and every one of us saying you have to extract the information from the books, from the videos, from the websites, and make your own note. So please, as an exercise towards that, for a successful cracking of different exam, you have to make your own note, and we believe you will also make your own note from the different session which are available in our Facebook account. And they will be for next 7 days. I should repeat again and again, they will be they will be available only for 7 days. After that, we will put it down. And we cannot answer whether which coaching classes you are there. You please do all the googling, do Google business for getting your coaching centers, and we are not here to help you on the coaching. Nidhi, there is one question why I wanted to request you to please say something about this to those who still who are not of mathematics background for numerical portion bit tough. Sir, if you want to crack geophysics, I would request you to get familiarized with mathematics. There is no shortcut to not knowing. You have to know what is being asked for. How can it they make it easy for themselves? Please go through some. Yes, as I have said, you have to learn yourself and get the numericals solved in the exam paper. Yeah, thank you very much. I think Nidhi will lunch right now, and we'll be here again on line at 2:45 p.m. Our esteemed next speaker, Sri P.V. Sukumaran, will be online from 3:30. He was in the interview board as a subject expert in GSI's examination in UPSC board I am talking about, and he will be sharing his ideas, his knowledge, how to crack the interview. Rather, he will share what will interviewer looks for in an interviewee. So be with us, and then, as we have been, many of you are asking whether there is a separate discussion session with the geophysics or geology. Yes, the 12 brightest officers, like four from geology, from four from chemistry, four from geophysics, who have recently cracked UPSC 2019 and joined Geological Survey of India, and they are undergoing training right now in different centers of GSI, Geological Survey of India Training Institute. They will be joining to take your questions, and they will be answering, and we'll be there with them to discuss whatever issues. Please jot down your issues, and I must request, as Nidhi has been saying since last year, yesterday, please ask one after another. We have sufficient time from 3:30 to 4:30. We will have 1 hour of discussion. It's a long hour, one long hour of discussion. Please take your time, ask one after another all the questions, and it will be sorted out. Okay. And somebody is writing, sir, are the questions in line with geophysical operations of GSI, or they test general graduate level geophysical knowledge? Sir, I think Mahanath Khanna has asked, please go through the lecture videos that I have been talking about. Go, we have live streamed yesterday. See the videos, your answer will be taken care of. Again, I have said we have no inkling about whether the post is getting reduced or whether there will be more post. Just wait and watch. As I said, this is not only for GSI examination, it is also preparing for you for taking up other PSC or UPSC examination. How to prepare note? You have to see the video and make your own note. Pause, write, and make your own note. I have already shared the Facebook link. I think I should share it again. I think it is available in the chat box quite high above. Just copy paste the same comment and paste it here. Somebody is asking again. Listen, it appears. I have said already at 3 live session starts, 2:45 you should be online. Okay. First, our guest speaker will be there from 3:30 to 3:45 to 4. After that, for about 45 to 1 hour, our 12 guests will be there. Ma'am, you have a question. Nidhi, you have a question.
Please don't use highlighters. Please don't use any other colors. Okay. Please use blue color pen and pencil for diagrams. That's all. Everything will be checked properly. Please be rest assured. This is the best institution which conducts exam in an unbiased and expertized manner. So everything will be checked. Please don't worry. Okay. It's not allowed. Please refer the notification.
Thank you all. See you at 2:45. We'll be there from onward, but I expect if you are there to join us from 2:30, it's okay, but be there at least from 2:45 onward. Thank you. Signing off for the timing right now.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you to all. So we'll again have a session at 3 and be there at 2:45. Thank you so much.